So I just wanted to tell you about that.
I want to pop you in the ring.
Terry, when I leave early, don't take a bed. I have to go pick my son.
Like hell. What time is it?
You want your mouth? But it mute. When I get out of the
That's why I was so glad to see you.
I'll sit up front with you.
Come on, nobody wants to sit with me.
Honey, I'll sit with you. I need some of that good stuff or rub off on me. Look, you came for big nuts, look, I came for little nuts. But
size doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. It's no taking, just take me.
All right. No promises.
Maybe they didn't have enough wine to wash it down.
Can you bring it again?
I will. We know what that will happen. Yeah. It's just a matter of time.
We have 2 minutes and we'll get started. So if you want to go to the bathroom or you need to get a bottle of water or whatever, do it now. 2 minutes, we'll get going. And by the way, this is being recorded, so if you want to take notes later on, you can reset out. They won't have a clue. They won't pay attention.
2 minutes.
So being more with everyone.
All right, well, Wanda Fitzgerald gets back. We don't get started. So
I got one of these so I can sit in the front row. I'm excited. I'm actually here in my car with
All right, y'all ready to get going? Okay, so before we get going, let's take another break. What do you say? Dean said, hey, this is a great class. We got a break before we even get started. So, before we get into the pricing equation, Debbie is making copies. So, if you do not have these sheets of paper, then raise your hand when Debbie comes back so that you can have them. This is being recorded, so if you want to go back, this will be recorded and then sent out in the link so that you guys can have a refresher. What I've experienced is sometimes you might come into classes like this and take away a couple of points. If you do not practice this stuff, you will not get good at this stuff. You will sound terrible and it will not work. However, if you practice this and you kind of go, hey, let me go do some self-thinking and self-talking with this, it can put you in a lot better control of pricing and controlling the seller by looking at it through the lens of how buyers buy. And that's what this is all designed from. It's not CMA. It has nothing to do with CMAs. You will not see one CMA conversation in this class. And it's all related to pricing. For those of you that don't know, before I started this company with my mother, I worked with Centex Homes for 6 years. And when they would go into a neighborhood, we had to go do the front-end work for them. So we had to go study the trends of an area, and they would give us a certain price point. They'd say $200,000 to $300,000. Go look in that area and find out what the market's doing. And we would have to go out there and go in every single builder's neighborhood and find the neighborhoods that are selling in that price quadrant, and then go out there and find out what are they building. And it didn't come down to necessarily square footage. It came down to what are the features they're building in that home, how many bedrooms, bathrooms, what are the garages, is it slab, is it basement, so on and so forth. And so it's a different way of looking at things, but that's all that I knew for 6 years. Up here, Debbie. Yep. So what we're going to teach is, if you were to look at threshold pricing, look at it from how a buyer starts online, how they really go through the process, what they look for in a home, how they come to you as an agent and they say, hey, if they're moving from California and they don't know you, and they say, I'm looking for a home up to $400,000, who in here would go start going to 410? I hope you would. Let me tell you something. Let me tell you guys something. I don't know you, and I'm moving from California, and I tell you 400, and you go, I'm above 400, you're probably not going to work with me that long, right? Now, if we go out there and we do not find what I'm looking for, then I will absolutely go up in price all day long. But as a consumer, as a person selling something, you need to listen to what the consumer is telling you. So threshold pricing, that door right there, to me signifies
if I'm a buyer and I'm looking for a price up to $400,000, I want you guys to have a mental picture in your head of where are some magical threshold lines that happen when people start looking for homes. And usually, if somebody's looking for a home and they call and they say, I need to get pre-qualified, and the lender says you can qualify up to, you buy a home up to $210,000. Most people do not go to 210 to start looking. What do? The psychological line. What do you think that line would be? If I could afford a home up to $210,000, where do you think a magical line would probably appear in my head?
Two.
Okay? That's what we call a threshold line. So everything is based off of psychological patterns. There's no absolutes in this, so it's like you can't take this and say it's going to work to perfection every single time. But what the whole thing is designed for is to help give you control and help talk a language different than what most sellers hear from agents. So what I've experienced through the years is if I go to a seller and I do a CMA and I say, well, Holly, your home compared to the one down the street is worth less than the one that sold down the street 6 months ago. Almost everybody in here is going to say, well, yeah, but my home has this feature, and there's no, that home was in terrible condition. Oh, they were so outdated. Oh, mine's better. Mine's that. I got the best lawn. I got the best home. I got the best plan in the best neighborhood. And all of a sudden, if you go a CMA route, you're in an adversarial spot because I'm telling you that your home is not worth the one down the street. I really didn't go in that home. And Holly's telling me, no, I was in that home, and my home is worth more than what it is. How far is that going to get you in a conversation with somebody that you're meeting most times for the first time? So, have y'all ever had that happen, by the way, where you give a CMA and the person says, oh, no, my home's better than that one. Oh, no, they sold because it was a desperate situation. Oh, no, they were in foreclosure. So if you go about it a one-to-one thing, they'll always win because their home is always better, regardless of if it is or is not. So in your mind, I want you to think threshold price. $200,000. Right now, just think $200,000 would be a great, big, thick, black line of a threshold price. And as we go into this, you'll learn more about it. So, it doesn't matter what it is, if it's a gas price. By the way, we just went through this. The gas price has got down to $2 a gallon. And they've been, what, close to $4 for a long time, and all of a sudden they go boom, 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 boom. And now when it got down to $2 a gallon, I'm sitting there going, hell, I don't, I'm going to go get the premium, even though I don't have to get the premium, I just, it just feels good, right? And all of a sudden, the closer it was getting to $2 a gallon, we're going, man, it would be great if it was $1.99. How many of y'all felt that? Where it's like all of a sudden, just from a price qualifier in there, you wanted it in your head to get to $1.99 for whatever reason. And it doesn't matter if we're looking at gas or if we're looking at shoes. These are for the ladies right here. For the guys, we got the shoe is a shoe, right? And if it's leather, it's leather. For the ladies, I've learned all my shoes here, so this is in order. Ladies over here to the left, we have the Jessica Simpson line. Right. Here in the middle, if I say JC, JC, JC as the initials, what would that be? Jimmy Choo. And then over here on the right, the big V, what is that? Versace. Okay? Victoria's Secret.
No.
It's a shoe of shoe. I mean, they're all leather. They're all some. They all look about the same except for this one down here, but those two look pretty close. Yet, there's a huge discrepancy in what the price is to what women pay and what they're willing to pay. And all this money goes into the psychology of buyers, what they're willing to pay for, and what value they start to contrive and perceive in their head. And it's on every single product that we buy out there. It doesn't matter what it is. Gasoline, you have an image in your head. If you go to a QT store, what experience you're going to get out of that, a BP service station, all the different ones. And then you go drive by some mom and pop one, and you go, okay, I don't know if I want to go in there. But the reality is, every single time you pass something that is for sale, you go through the same psychological process. So my question is, why do we screw it up as agents and how we go price things? All the millions of dollars that go into marketing experiences, $1.99 versus $2, And why does all that happen? And why can't we take that experience? It's always blown me away. Why don't agents practice what the true marketers do in their pricing? Okay. So neighborhoods are brands just the same as shoes. So each community is designed to meet the expectations of a buyer pool. And when I say a buyer pool, that can be a $100,000 block, it can be a $25,000 block, it can be a $50,000 block. But every single neighborhood is designed. That developer goes out there and says, in this area, I'm going to develop this neighborhood, and I'm going to focus on this price point. Now, what do I got to do so that my neighborhood in that wedge can sell very well, and I can make my yield, and everything works out, and I can give those buyers the experience they're looking for that price block, because it's just the same thing as the price of jeans, shoes, dresses, anything else. So I want you to be thinking like this. Same psychological process. Think the way that marketers do. We're going to back into a couple things that as a professional real estate agent, you need to learn what these things are. Let me get Austin in here. Austin!
Yeah, baby.
Austin!
I thought we were going to watch a movie. I mean, if we didn't mention something about a recording, we're not watching a movie.
So, wait, now they're watching me. All right, so let me ask you. You're getting your attention back again. Let me ask you a question. Who can tell me what the basis is, if I were to say, what are the odds of a home selling? What is that? Who can tell me without looking at the board and reading all the verbiage up here? Nope. Who can tell me if I say, Debbie, can you come in to me and explain to me what the odds of a home selling is?
The odds are good if you price it correctly.
Okay. Anybody have any formula? Don't look at the back behind me of what they would interpret of what that might mean to somebody. Because to me, in pricing, in marketing a home, every one of you should know what is the general basis behind what are the odds of a home selling or not. And here's your formula. It's right there on your sheet. So the odds of a home selling, we're going to cover a couple things that you need to practice these things and get them in line. Train your brain so that you can sound like the hero, not the zero. Sound different than the other agents are. And by the way, nobody talks this stuff. As a testament, nobody in here had an idea of really what it is.
That isn't it.
So really,
flip
the page.
Come on, people. Come on.
They were like, so
I was just saying.
It's the back page.
So this will show someone what the odds of their home selling is in the next blank days. And I'm going to tell you, as an agent, I always looked at things and said, okay, what's going to give me a competitive advantage over the other agents? In the tough markets, I had people saying, I'm only going to list a home if they'll list with me for 6 months. And I looked at it and said, I never want to list a home for more than 90 days because, good Lord, if I can't make them happy in 90 days, I don't want to be working with them another six or another 3 months. But I also looked at it and said, hey, if I went out there and said, I'm only going to list it for 90 days, and other agents went out and said, I need 120, then who looks better as a professional agent? Now I said, hey, that gives me a good spin. And I can say, hey, I only need 90 days because I want your happiness. And if I can't have you happy and I haven't sold your home, we don't need to have a contract for longer than 90 days. And I was looking and said, how can I spin that where it looks like I'm more professional and able to do things that the others aren't? And by the way, if somebody's happy with you in 89 days, they will relist. And then you get a fresh number and everything works better that way anyway. But the odds of a home selling in the next 90 days, this is your formula for putting it in. And everybody usually calls you as their agent and they say, I've got the best home in the best neighborhood. It's going to sell. There's no question. The odds of my home selling is 100%. And it doesn't matter how good the market is. You need to go in there, especially in the higher price ranges, and find out what are the odds numbers so that when you're going into somebody's home to list it, you know what the odds are of any home being put into that market over the next 90 days of having that home sell. And be able to articulate. So we're not going to spend too much time on some of these formulas, but I want you to see this and I want you to think about it. Here's the example. If there are 50 actives and over the last 90 days, very simple, you go on FMLS, you go back 90 days, you put in, give me the closing since the last 90 days. You plug that into the formula. If there are 50 active homes and 25 sold in the last 90 days, then that would give you a 50% odds of a home selling in that market, okay, over the next 90 days. Very simple. Now, we're not going to spend much time on this, but will y'all devote to going in and pulling things up? This is what I recommend to you guys. Go to your specific home in your neighborhood and go find out what the odds are of your home selling in the next 90 days. And everything, when I tell you to go back and look at a market, you look at the high school district. This is absolute. Do not deviate from this. Do not deviate from looking at the market as a high school market. You need to have enough statistics, enough data, and usually the high school area will give you enough that you can sound and have enough information to make yourself sound better. But y'all go study this stuff. Absorption rate. Well, now we're talking absorption rate. To me, if you're going to be talking pricing, you need to know the odds of a home selling, and you need to know the absorption rate. Who can tell me what an absorption rate means? It's a true look of supply and demand. How many months worth of inventory are there? But how do you find that answer out? I made it very easy for you. Here's your step-by-step thing of finding out what are the month supply, what's your absorption rate on a specific area. So all I got to do is follow the steps right down here. I want to make it so easy, but this is stuff that if you will go in and have armed behind you, you'll be sounding a heck of a lot better than the other agents that don't have a clue as to what it is. And it's a simple formula. But all it means is in any given market, without adding any other home into the mix, based off the last X months of sales, usually 6 months of sales will get you what you need, putting that into the pattern, if we didn't add one more home, then it would take, based off last 6 months of sales pace, another 4 months, 5 months to absorb all the homes that are in this given market. Period. Okay? And usually it's longer than your 90-day listing period. So, by the way, kind of glossing over this stuff, but I want you guys to know what you need to learn how to talk. And if you haven't learned any of this stuff before, I'm more than happy to sit down with you and show you, but you've got to get this stuff down.
Terry, yes. All that information is in the FMLS and those statistical reports.
It is.
But they're a month behind.
But no, that's on a one-year basis. Do not take FMLS. This is where you got to own your business. I want you going in there with this formula and going back 6 months. FMLS does a 12-month trailing period. Okay. How many sales from a year ago really matter in today's market?
None.
But thank you for bringing that up, because this is the stuff where sometimes you going out there and doing a little extra effort and work on your own will give you a heck of a lot better understanding of the market and have you a lot better control. So in talking months of inventory, this is what you guys need to know. In any market, and this does not fluctuate, this is your month supply of inventory. If you have 0 to 3 months, that is one heck of a seller's market. That is awesome. You want to be in that if you're a seller. 3 to 6 months is great. 6 to 9 months is okay. 9 to 12 months is proceed with caution. And 12 plus months is look out and price aggressively. You got to get these things drilled down in your head. So if you're talking to somebody and say the average or the absorption rate in this market is 6 months supply of inventory, what that means to you is this. And you go educate them on what that means. And this is where you bundle everything up and start talking like a professional and have people go, why wouldn't I listen to this person? They know all the analytics. They know what they're doing. And then the others that just do a simple CMA and pray that everything works out, you don't look as good, okay? So this is kind of a little snapshot of what we're going to be talking about in threshold pricing. Threshold pricing is based off human nature. Most everyone thinks their home is worth more than what it truly is. So if you go into it knowing, I know every single seller, now is that absolute, does that mean that some sellers are on the mark? Yes, some sellers are on the mark, but 9 out of 10 times. Sellers think their home is worth more than what it actually is. Would y'all agree with that?
Yes.
Okay. So most people think they have the best lot, the best home, the best kitchen, the best floor plan, and the best whatever. Whatever price point they told you, they will research that block. You will research that block and of price and the one below that price. We're going to get into this later, but these blocks right here, these are your typical threshold lines that will make sense. So in the 400, you're usually going to have 400 as a threshold, 450 is a threshold, 500 is a threshold. We're going to be covering with you guys from the 100s and up how the threshold lines typically work, because they do get smaller, the lower price you go. But I just want...
Mom is doing it.
It's my bad.
She's doing the best.
Is he messing up?
Yeah.
These two right here.
Exactly.
It was my magnetic.
Of course.
Hey, Rob, would you open the back door back there?
No, you should be. I think we've really done it this time.
There's a lot of hot air in here.
Yeah, you should have charged his battery. Oh, good, it's movie time again.
He had me a fog sketcher.
Yeah. How about the Hobbit?
Sweating out in the summertime, I'm okay.
The Hobbit, Terry, can we just watch the Hobbit?
Now, what is the situation here, Austin? Okay, so you can follow along on your sheet, and I can keep going. So here's the deal. Is the next one the five-feature pricing system up at the top? Is that what it says?
Yeah.
Okay. This is what I'm going to tell you. Do not get confused in what buyers typically will tell you that they're looking for in a home. You have five fundamental features of a plan that when we went out to research Syntex homes and what they should be putting into a home in a given area, in a given market, five features that we would have to go study were foundation. When I say foundation, that means, was it a basement or a slab? If it was a basement, it could be a finished basement, right? It could be a crawl space. So foundation is what is the foundation of the home? Exterior finish, that's brick or stucco or siding. Bedroom bathroom ratio. When you go plug in different price points, you'll see the higher in price you go. Lori, we're gonna look at the Home and Old Atlanta Club that expired. Lori had a listing that expired. The home had three bedrooms upstairs, including the master. The master bedroom was upstairs and had two secondary bedrooms and one secondary bathroom. In the 400s, do you think that would be an obstacle to overcome? Absolutely. Now, the people is on a very nice lot, but that is one of the things that you can say, hey, you know, based off the buying patterns of the people in the 400 to 450 price point, that lack of the fourth bedroom upstairs and lack of the bathroom upstairs is going to greatly limit your opportunity of getting that home sold at 420. And you know, at that time, Lori went into it, and I'm going to pick on you a little bit, but Lori went into it and said, I can sell this home, okay? And sometimes as agents, you get into it and go, I'm going to be able to sell this home. And you can't sell something to somebody that they don't want to buy. But your whole goal is get those five features to line up as good as they possibly can and evaluate how does that stack up with the buying choices of what people have bought. So in that equation, we're going to look at it and go, hey, above $400,000, how many homes do you think sold above $400,000 with only three bedrooms upstairs, including the master? Because you will have homes that have two secondary bedrooms upstairs, but the master's on the main. That'll sell all day long in the fours, but not the master upstairs. It looks smaller online. People won't get to the door as much as they would if you had that extra bedroom. That's the type of stuff that you're going to be looking at. Master location, that's simply either up or down. And then garage. Garage could be two-car furniture garage. It could be you got a drive-under garage. How much of a drive-under garage? If you're in the $300,000 price point and you have a drive-under garage, how much of a critical aspect is that for buyers in that price point? It's a garage, but it's a drive-under. What's the impact that really has and really being able to focus on that versus saying, well, the home down the street sold for this, and the people are going, well, my home's nicer than that. And maybe it was, but it had a two-car garage on the main level. What difference would that make? So we're going to dive into this. But how buyers buy?
There we go.
You found the price ceiling, mind your head. So here's a guy, and I want to have some visual things where you can go, hey, this is really what people start to go through. This guy was looking up at, let's say, $300,000 or $400,000, doesn't matter. Here's his threshold line. He says, I want to buy a home and I want to keep my price under this amount. They start the process. They go, what is really our desired outcome? What is the home that we really want to have that matches what we want? We'd like to have a three-sided brick home, four bedrooms, three baths, two-car side entry garage, unfinished basement, and master up. Okay, and they start going around in an area and they start looking for that combination in that price block. Now, do you think in most price blocks that are in lower price ranges, they will hit all of those three sides brick, four bedrooms and three baths upstairs with a master up and an unfinished basement. So what do you think, what's the process that people go through? You as a buyer, you go out there and you say, this is what I'd like to have, and you go out there and you find out, well, what we thought we were looking for, we absolutely cannot find in the price range that we really wanted to be in. What do you do? No, I'm saying what you do as the consumer. You're the consumer.
You either adjust your expectations or you go up in price.
Adjust your expectations or you start to go up in price. And then still in this equation might need to adjust some of your expectations and adjust your price. Okay, so I will tell you in my story with people, whenever I go list a home, I would always tell them, I'd say, look, here's the deal. Let's say that you're a buyer moving from California, and you call me as your agent, and you don't know me from Adam or Austin, and you tell me I'm looking for a home up to, say, $300,000, and here's what I'm looking for. I've got to earn your trust and respect as a buyer's agent, so I'm not going to go a dime above $300,000. If I do, you're not going to work with me anymore. And everybody will be sitting there going, okay, this makes sense. Now, if we go out there and we're looking for what you want and we can't find it, you'll always go up $5,000 to $10,000. But that's when you tell me, well, let's go ahead and go up a little bit more to see what we can get. And that's what we call a creep over buy. And this is part of the equation that we're going to be talking about in how you price things and how you stair-step things down is educating the consumer how buyers buy. And guess what the great thing is about the home that they're selling? They bought it. They went through this process. How many of you, when you bought your home that you're in today, paid more than what you really ultimately wanted to spend before you walked out the door? One? Usually everybody. Let me ask you this. I want to get participation. Who didn't spend more than what they really wanted? Wow. Well, y'all bought at the bottom of the market. Okay, well, Heather, you might have paid less, but your husband paid more. Heather's going, we didn't pay him what I wanted. So, buyers go out there and they do these threshold lines. If they can't find what they're looking for, they will always inch up. As a seller, is that important that you go back and think about how a buyer buys? Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Okay. Now, I, as a listing agent, I got to find out what's ticking in your head. I got to find out what you think. So, in just a second, there we go. You call me to come list your home. Or say, hey, we want you to come talk about listing our property. I need to find out before I walk in your door what you think your value of your home should fall within. And all I need to do is I need a $25,000 to $50,000 range that you believe your home will sell within. Okay? In order for me to do my work as an agent. Now, how many of you guys are finding out what the seller's expectations are before you walk in the door? 30%. Do you have a question that you can ask? Most people go, I don't feel comfortable in asking a question because most people are going to say, well, you're the agent. That's why I'm having you come up. And more agents are fearful of asking that question because they're fearing that the buyer, the seller is going to say, I don't want to tell you. That's why I'm having you come out. Shut up and come out. And I've had agents, I'm being harsh, but I've had agents not ask the question the right way. If you're a consumer and you were thinking, I would not want to tell an agent what my price is because I really want to see how they think. If I ask you, could you give me a $25,000 to $50,000 range so that I can do my job effectively? And when I come over, I'll be able to talk about the analytics and what's going on in your marketplace so I can better serve you. Nobody has a problem with that. So find out the $25,000 to $50,000 range of price before you go in. Your goal is to get inside their head as much as you can to see if what they believe their home is worth can be supported by the buying trends in the marketplace. The more you can understand them, the better chance you can have of following you in this presentation. Okay. Now, getting to the numbers. Now, I can pull out my computer here. I've got it here. I've got FMLS plugged in. But I want to talk about what I believe you should know going into a given home before you walk in the door. So what is the range of the community? And when I say range, what is the price range of the community that you're going into? So I'll give you an example. Old Atlanta Club. And I'll reference Old Atlanta Club just because I've studied that neighborhood for 20 plus years. It's ingrained in me, so it's very easy for me to talk it. But Old Atlanta Club, I can tell you, it goes from the 300s up into the 500s, period. The main meat and potatoes of that neighborhood is really from the mid-300s into the mid-400s. Once you get above the mid-400s, it gets very difficult to sell. It's a more challenged sale, so unless it's got premium lot, premium this, it's more challenged. But in that price range, 350 to 450, you're going to have good traffic regardless what it is, and you're probably going to get something to sell as long as you price it in the hemisphere of what it needs to be. Where's the community sweet spot? We went over that in Old Land Club, be 350 to 450. What communities are in competition for the sweet spot? And by the way, every single thing that we're talking about, you always pull from the high school district. So in this case, we'd be looking at Lambert High School. And if I'm going into Old Atlanta Club, we'll say I'm going into Old Atlanta Club. The home, the people believe, is around $400,000 to $425,000 in range. I'm going to go in there and start finding out who's my competition of neighborhoods outside of Old Atlanta Club. Now, who lives in South Forsyth that they might be able to say, you know, in South Forsyth, who lives in South Forsyth? Raise your hand. Okay. Do y'all know competition for Old Atlanta Club? 350 to 450 communities.
My neighborhood,
Windermere,
Arden Green, Bennington,
Three Chimneys,
South.
South. Laurel. That's South Forsyth High School. Laurel Springs, maybe Laurel Springs.
Three Chimneys.
Laurel Springs on the low side of Laurel Springs.
Yeah. I think these new
Glen Creek maybe on the high side of Glen Creek. Aberdeen on the high side.
Yeah.
Three Chimneys. River Mist. Bottom end of St. Marlowe.
Deer Lake.
Deer Lake.
St.
Marlowe. Yeah, Deer Lake. You go look at, here's what you guys need to do. So in this, you go out there and you go, I'm going to go back the last 6 months of sales. So in any study that you're going to be doing, you go back 6 months of sales in the high school district from the meat and potatoes of the neighborhood that you're studying. And you're going to find out who are the competing neighborhoods. What are the neighborhoods that are having the highest velocity of sales? As a seller, do you think that's important to know what your competition is? Let's say in a neighborhood you got one home that's active. From 350 to 450, you've got one. And then another neighborhood has five. As an agent, which one are you going to go show first to your clients? Usually you're going to go show the ones that has the most opportunities for you to, you know, show homes. So usually one has five homes, you go to first. So does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
So, and by the way, if you educate people and just talk real with them, you'll be surprised at how far that gets you. We sometimes, a lot of times, clog up our thinking and it gets people confused. And you're not able to get them off the emotional seller's ledge where they think, they can't think logically. And all this does is kind of break things down into buying patterns of people, studies a market, looks at the five fundamental features, goes back and applies the psychological process of buying to it, and helps you just have control. And, you know, my favorite comment to people when they go, well, I just believe my home is worth this. And after all, you listed it. You know, I believe your home is worth every penny where we have it listed. But unfortunately, all I can do as a professional realtor is go look at the buying trends of the people in this buying block. And as you can see, they bought homes that did not, that had this feature that your home doesn't have. I can't say anything else. I mean, I believe your home is worth every penny, but it doesn't have this feature. And obviously, that's a huge feature that we got to consider. So I think we're priced in the wrong buyer block. Attract a person to come in your home. And that's how the conversation ends up going. Now, did I tell you that your home's not worth it? No, I said, I believe your home is worth every penny where we got it listed. But unfortunately, all I can do as a professional realtor is study the buying trends of the people in these buyer blocks and relate it to what your home has versus what the people bought. And that's all that matters, right? Okay. So we're gonna use this as an example going into it. We're gonna go pull up Old Atlanta Club and FMLS. We're gonna roll through this stuff first.
Patience.
All right. So think like a builder. If you are building a home in your given area and your given price point, think like the builder thinks. And you look at it and go, hey, I've got a listing appointment on this home. It's got 3 bedrooms, 2.5 baths, it's on a slab, it's stucco, it's synthetic. The question is, would you build that in the market today? If you went out there and you studied the marketplace, would you build the product that you're getting ready to list and dump it into the market today? And that's what you got to start looking at, going, you know what, I need to get really good at this, because if I know that the product is challenged for the market today, then I need to act like a builder, see what I can change, and if I can't change the product, then I need to change the market. I need to change the buyer pool. We'll have a chance of getting that thing off the plate, given the challenges that we got in the market today. So act like a builder. You know, the advantage the builders have, they go do focus groups. They send agents out there. They study the different things. They put them on a chart. And it's so less to do with square footage and so much more to do with the fundamental features of a home. And then the fluff stuff, it's just fluff. That helps get the emotional connection to get people to buy, but the stuff that gets them there is the neighborhood first, and then the fundamental features that the homes offer within that given neighborhood. Be the doctor. You know, you'll see in a second. Be the doctor. You can see it down there. Your job, your primary job, is to find the ill.
Surely that's not a doctor. That's about 14.
It's Doogie Howser.
I'm not going with that.
Because it's real estate. We had that house in there. It's Doogie Howser. Your job is to find the ill. You know, I wanted this. Here's your buyer pool. And you know what they're saying? That home sucks for what we're looking for. I mean, seriously, I want you to think about that. Your job as a professional real estate agent is to communicate and go out there and find what is the ill of the home that's impeding it from being entered into the market for that potential buyer pool. Okay? And think of this. Here's your buyers right there. There's your sample pool. And they're going, no, thank you. This is, we want a 5-bedroom palace, not that 3-bedroom thing. We need a 3-car garage, not a 2-car side entry garage. Psychological lines. We're going to go into this. We're going to kind of play a little role play, and I do expect some interaction back. So, psychological lines. We're going down. Okay? So, blank 19.9 is a psychological chance. Blank 14.9 is a good chance. Blank 0.99 is a better chance. 0.49 is the best chance. And 0.00 is your optimal threshold. And we're going to stop on this right here, and we're going to take a minute, because this is really some of the language that you're going to have to see this, and you're going to have to get into it and go, hey, my pricing strategies when I listed and sold, and I sold a lot of homes and did a lot of business, and I communicated effectively, and people were over $1 million, under $100,000, this process works very well. It's non-argumentative. But 4999 was my pricing strategy. 4999. So remember, I started off saying, you know, we got millions of dollars that are spent on marketing techniques, strategies, psychological studies to see why do companies go enter a product and they label it as 4999? I look at it and go, hey, if all those millions of dollars go into that, why don't we practice that stuff? Now, I do know that there's certain markets where you can use eights in the numbers, and it makes it a more sellable number and more presentable to Asian markets go into that, right?
Yeah.
So 888, I think, is a real high
thing.
But in our society around here, I always go forward with, if it's not a 4999, it does not need to have a price for me given on it. Because if you go into it with this principle, 4999, then when somebody goes to you and says, well, my home is 169.9 right now, I tell you what, let's take $2,000 off. Is that going to make a difference? I tell you what, I'm going to let you reduce the price. Go down to 167.9. Might as well keep it where it is. Think about how people look online. They look online in a $5,000 to $10,000 block, right? They don't go online in a $2,000 to $25,000. No. It's a $5,000 to $10,000 gap. So you price it according to how people look online. 4999. If you can't get into a line that matters, then don't even make the price adjustment. $2,000 is not going to make a difference. I don't care what price it is. It's not going to make a difference to somebody seeing it. It's not going to be making a difference to somebody making an offer. So Here's how things look. Let's say that your line was a $400,000 line. Here's how the equation would work.
We've got cars that need to be moved and the CC's truck's trying to get out. If you're parked on the side, please move your car. If you're parked along Ronald Reagan, please move your car.
We're parked on Ronald Reagan.
You mean out, well, facing right here. Along the side.
Parallel to Ronald Reagan.
If you're not in a parking space that's facing the building, you need your car moved.
Or the truck will just move me out of the way. Okay, so I'm going to give you guys an example. Heather had a listing that she called me on in Old Atlantic Club. And she said, what do you think about the price? And she went over some of the things and I said, here's the range that that home would be able to sell within. It was a slab on a golf lot, updated. Four bedrooms, 3.5 baths with a master on the main. I knew the area and I said, you know, the range would be $399,900. It flies off the shelf, $419,900. So think of this. $399,900, it flies off the shelf. $419,900, you have a psychological chance of having the buyer still go in the door. That's going to be the best chance of selling and being the one that buys that home. The buyer for that home is the buyer that's looking up to $400,000, period. So the question is, where do you have to price it to have that buyer that's looking up to $400,000 that will buy a slab on the golf course versus needing to have a basement? The higher you get into the 400s, guess what? That basement will kill a slab sale, right? But the one that's looking up to $400,000, how can you get them in your door? A seller wants to price it as high as they possibly can, right? You have to communicate a strategy that helps get them to see I might be pricing it high. This is the buyer that we're looking for. It's the one that's looking up to $400,000. Which, by the way, did I tell you your home's not worth it? No. The buyer that's going to be buying the home with the slab is the one that's looking up to $400,000. The question is, how close to $400,000 do we have to price it to have them come in your door? If we start at $419,900, we have a psychological chance. Because anybody looking up to $400,000, put yourself in the buyer's shoes. You're now looking for a home. You're looking for a home up to $400,000, your optimal threshold line. You can't find what you're looking for, or you're looking online and you see this home that dazzles you. It's like, wow, that is awesome. But it's a little higher than what we really want to spend. Who in here, raise your hand, would go 4049 to 4099 if you were looking up to $400,000? Raise your hand if you would. Raise your hand if you would go into CA home that was 4049. Everybody should be raising their hand. Raise your hand and you're nodding your head. Keep your hand raised for this exercise. If you are a buyer and you would go creep over to get 4049, would you go to 4149?
Yes.
Would you go to 4199?
Yes.
Would you go to 425?
No. Maybe.
Look around the room. We had four hands raised and two raised and two maids. Okay.
Yeah.
Everybody would go through this process, and even if they would themselves would go into the 420s, there is a line where you drop off. Okay. So the beauty of this is you can say, hey, look, I'm going to tell you this. On her home, the slab was the component. If the home had a basement, she probably would have gone 460s, right? But since it didn't have a basement, it was on a slab. It was like, you're limited. The buyer for your home that's going to accept that slab is going to be one that's looking for $400,000. And because it's got the right bedroom-bathroom ratio, because it's brick, because it's on the golf course, and because it's updated, it's going to attract that person to go, hey, you know what? Even though it doesn't have the basement, I'm going to be willing to look at it up to 400. And man, 419.9, still that 4.1 to the consumer is pretty much 410, right? It's the 4.1. It's all the same psychological stuff that the people invest those millions of dollars. And you go, hey, there's a lot that you can learn from what general products do and sell. And if you just turn around and start talking this to the consumer that's selling their home, it gets them off the emotional ledge, and you go, hey, there's no doubt the buyer that's going to be willing to buy your home is one looking up to 400. Now, I'm not sharing with you that we need to price it below 400. you've got an X on this, that, and the other. I feel compelled that the person that's looking up to that point will be willing to spend a little bit more. The question is how much more. So, and your whole goal in this is to get it at, if you can get it 400, great. But if you can't, you need to explain this and say, you know what? Because you have these other things and it's updated, I feel fine going to 419.9. It's going to show well online, and I think that, you know, we've got a good chance, or at least a psychological chance at 419.9. Now, what I'm going to share with you is if we find that the buyers that come through here aren't interested in it, then we're attracting the wrong buyers, and we will need to adjust the price down closer to that $400,000 line. That make sense? And by the way, just where everybody was nodding their head, guess what your sellers are going to do? But you explain it to them, and you go, does that make sense? And they go, yeah, it does. And so if you get into understanding how to really process this, this is a great stair-stepping thing where 30 days go by, the home hadn't sold. You've had plenty of showings go through it. And the people go, well, my home hadn't sold. What more can you do? Well, I tell you what, I've gone and I've checked all the marketing, and everything looks great. I adjusted a couple things. But overall, the marketing is everything that I want it to be. It's a successful marketing campaign. What do we need to do? Well, all I can do is look at the market and compare the five fundamental features. Remember, that slab was a big component for the buyers, and the buyer that we were really looking for is looking up to $400,000. So the question is, how fast do you need to get the home sold, and how close can we get the price down to $400,000? And only you really hold the answer to that. But I can tell you, every $5,000 to $10,000 step we go towards 400, we greatly increase the chance of your home getting sold. By the way, half the room is nodding their head. Mm-hmm. This is the beautiful stuff behind this. Have I said one thing about your home not being worth what you think it is? Okay. So what should we do? Should we drop $5,000? You know what? I can't tell you what you should drop it, but all I can tell you is the closer you get to the threshold line of $400,000, the better chance you have of getting that buyer in here that's going to end up buying your home. I mean, if you can go down to $399.9, that's fantastic, but I don't know if you're ready for that. If you're ready for that and you need to sell in the next 30 days, then we probably should go to $399.9 because then you're definitely getting straight in that pool. Because here's the reality. We don't know. Inventory could be higher out there. We could have had a lot more inventory get introduced, and the buyers are finding their homes in their first searches. They're not having to creep up. So we got to go research that and see, are the homes selling down here and they're not even having to go up a little bit and they're finding what they're looking for or what? And that's how you kind of evaluate things out. Does that make sense? Okay. So I label these out going psychological chance, because the further out you go, that's the furthest out I'd go. You can't go to the 420s. And just remember the sample pool in here. I said, who would got 404 or 409? Half of you nodded your head. The other half raised your hand like we were supposed to. Yes, we do that. I said, what about 414.9? And about 20 to 30%, I don't know about 414.9. And then when I went to 419.9, about 50 to 60% dropped their hands. When I went to 420, I went to 425, but it didn't matter if I said 420. 42, four people had their hand raised out of this group. And that's exactly what you'll see going through the process. Now, what I want you to do is I want you to take a minute and go, okay, we're going to go into $100,000 to $200,000. When you get down in the lower price points, from 100 to 200, your buyer blocks get smaller. So from $100,000 to $200,000, actually from $100,000 to $300,000, you have $25,000 buyer blocks. So what I want you guys to do is I want you to take 1 minute, and I want you to write down $100,000 as your buyer block line, and then I want you to go to 125, draw that off, 100 threshold line, 125 threshold line, 150 threshold line, 175, go all the way up to $300,000. I am going to check. I'm going right there. Now, this is what you guys are going to need to do. Go practice this and start training your brain. When you get to $300,000, something magical happens. And if you talk to people, if you've talked to enough buyers, this is over years and years of watching people, studying people, going, hey, what are the patterns of people? How do they shop? What do they look online? If you go talk to them, when they get to 300, sometimes they start going from $25,000 to $50,000 blocks. So in the 300s, from 3 to 400,000, you go 3 to 325, or actually do 3 to 350, but then do a light
325. Okay? So you go 3 to 325, but make it a light 325, and then 350, and then a light 375, and then a 400. Steve, you're looking at me like, what the hell are you talking about? So these are the lines. 300, it goes 25. People go, I'm looking 3 to 350, right? That's why they start jumping up. Or they're looking 3 to 325 or 325 to 350. So make those lighter. You get in the fours, it definitely goes to a $50,000 buyer block. So what would those be? 400s would be what? What are my buyer blocks in the 400s? 450. 4 to 450 and 450 to 5. Okay? So I'm going to ask you guys this. I'm looking from 3 to 325. I want you to tell me, what are the numbers here? So 325 is my buyer block, right? This is my threshold line, 325. What is my best chance price? 325 is my threshold line. 329.9 is my best chance. What is my better chance?
334.9. 334.9. This is hard. Yeah. Where's the movie? I'm filming you. You're the movie.
There is no easier math. Like, that's the thing.
We did 300. Everybody
would have had it. Okay. Let's go 300. Tell me what the lines are.
3049.
Well, that's too damn easy. Well, that would be 3049.
Yeah. Exactly. That was my point. I'm doing the math quick.
Okay. Draw it out. Okay. I'm going to draw another one. I'm looking up to 375. I'm going to give you guys 2 minutes to draw this out. And I'm going to randomly call on people to tell me the best chance, better chance, good chance. I'm looking up the 375. What are the chances of me going into that home?
375 is your optimal threshold, right?
375 is the optimal threshold. I will give that to you.
79.9. 4.9.
Taking all the mystery out of it over here with D.
Who's ready? What is my best chance?
379.9.
Denise was very excited. I'm ready. 374.0.
322. That's optimum.
379.9. My buyer block, I'm looking up to 375. 379.9 is the best chance. What is the next one? 384.9. What is a good chance?
389.9.
Trick question. What's the psychological chance?
399.
Wrong. There isn't one.
Because it went up.
Because you would be in the 400.
It went up into the next thing, see? Okay. So that was my little trick question for you. So, but this is what I want to cover with you guys. By the way, does that make sense? So since you'd be going into since you'd be going to 394.9, there's no psychological advantage in 394.9. Might as well be 399, right? So unless you can get it 389, there is no chance of getting that buyer that's looking at 375, really. There's no difference of being 400 versus 394.9. There's just no difference. So when you hit those middle ranges, you just got to apply a little logic behind it. But I'm telling you, if you can get this down and go, hey, if I'm looking 125, what are my lines? Throw them out quick. Let's see. 129.9. 134.9. 139.9. What about psychological? There ain't one.
Right.
Okay. 150. What are my lines?
154.9. 159.9. 164 gun.
And is there,
is there
a psychological advantage at 169.90?
No.
Yes.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
Yes. Well, for 170.
No. So at 150. So your 50s, they go to 69. That's the same thing as at 119. It's a psychological opportunity to get that person to come in the door because it's only $10,000 more in there in the way that they look at numbers. That makes sense.
Yes, it makes total sense.
And this is something I'm going to tell you. What I started doing when I got when I left the new home sales and I started doing the general stuff, I just started quizzing myself. I'd go look in $25,000 to $50,000 block. I'd go look online in FMLS and I'd say, okay. What are the difference makers? And it was slab versus basement was a big thing, brick versus stucco. And I started just kind of qualifying things out and go, where are the lines where all of a sudden you start to see things make a difference of bedroom, bathroom configurations, of the basement versus slab, of finished basement versus slab, of three-car garage versus two-car garage, of side entry versus front entry. And I really just started diving in and going, where are the lines that make a difference? And then how can I apply that to communicate with the seller to get the control of the price? And I'm telling you, I went about every single day and I just studied this area and I studied this area and studied this area because I was like, there's something in this that is better than what's being taught out there. And then I heard about the odds of a home selling. I heard about the absorption rate and all that stuff. And it's like, if you can really start piling all this stuff together, you'll be amazed at how much control that you have. But you'll also go, hey, does it really make sense to talk CMAs? CMAs can make sense in some ways, but when you communicate with the seller about reducing their price, you get into a conflict because you're telling them their home is not worth what they think it is based off the home down the street. Yes.
Well, what do you think about going like between best and better chance? You know, if you have a price range in between those.
Is there a price range in between those?
That's what I'm asking.
No.
Okay.
Your absolutes. There is no price. These are the prices. $4,999, $4,999, $4,999. By the way,
you were in the last election, weren't you? Was it 999?
I'll put you outside.
Wasn't that you?
Yeah. Okay. So here's how it typically goes. Watch this. It's going to be great. I'm going to touch it, and it's going to switch.
Yay.
Oh, it's going to go blank.
Oh. Oh.
Movie
so,
time.
Look at this. Think about the buyer blocks. You can see I made it easy for you. 1 through 300,000, you got the $25,000 blocks. 3s through the 5s, they're 25 to 50. 500 to a million, they go to $100,000 buyer block. 1 million and above, typically you're looking at $250,000. So once you get above a million, people tend to look. One to a quarter, 1.5. Okay. So all I gotta do is have the cheat sheets in here and go, let me go look at the pool, let me go look at the high school district, let me go look at the last 6 months of sales, and let me go find what the ills are from the five fundamental features of the home I'm going in to see, and let me start drilling in on that and seeing how important is that feature to the buyer. So you already wrote out the buyer blocks through $400,000. Find the old home. Here's what we're going to do. We're going to go in and we're going to take a home in Old Atlanta Club that expired. And now it's on the market. And this is it. $420,000. Now, if you go study this stuff and you get into the numbers and you go, hey, I want to become a master of this stuff. It's very easy to do, but it takes time. But I can look at this and go, well, it's a two-car front entry garage. And you got to play the what-if game. What if that home had a two-car side entry garage? What if it had a three-car garage? If this home had a three-car garage with a 3-2 upstairs, no bedroom, bathroom, no full bathroom on the thing, but a finished basement, might that draw in a $400,000 plus buyer?
Yes.
If it had a three-car garage. Yeah, I think it would. That would be high desirable. Above $400,000 would be a three-car garage. What would this home, what would it take to get this home to really be that compelling of a home to drive those people in there? And I'll tell you this, the three bedrooms upstairs with the master up is the kiss of death when you go above $400,000. When you go above $300,000, it gets even more challenging. Because as a consumer looking online, do you think, oh, that's a small home. Three bedrooms and two baths upstairs?
It's master's really a upstairs, two.
That's small, right? Mm-hmm. Actually, this home has a loft area upstairs. But as how consumers look online, it's a 3-2. Even though you could finish that loft off into a bedroom, still a 3-2. It doesn't show, your perception of it is small just because of the 3-2. What would it take, in your opinion, what if we had a bedroom and a bathroom on the main level? Full bath and a bedroom on the main level. Would that make a difference?
Yes.
Would it sell at 420 if you had a bedroom and a bathroom on the main level?
Yes.
I believe it would. What about just a side entry garage as opposed to a front entry garage? Two car front side entry garage.
Yes.
Yeah.
No. 420 would be the same.
With a
3-2? With a 3-2. Everything the same. Exactly.
Oh yeah, I think that might make a lot of difference because a lot of people don't want rent.
I think
it's
psychological. It would for
me.
We don't know on that one. I can tell you with almost certainty that the bedroom and bathroom on the main level or an extra bedroom and bathroom upstairs or a three-car garage, those would be absolutes, no questions asked. It would sell all day long. The two-car side entry garage with all the other variables in there, I don't know, but I can tell you, you'd be surprised. At how much do you think? And who's got experience in this? How much do you think a side entry garage, let's say two homes side by side, that exact same home next door had a two-car side entry garage, what do you think difference in price that would bring to the consumer?
20 grand.
15.
15 to 20.
$15,000
to $20,000.
I did that in Stony Brook.
Like
I got two properties.
Yeah.
And then you got to
have 30
on the side. Hey, well, an appraiser, I think your marketability is somewhere between $15,000 to $20,000 when you get above $300,000. That exact home next door with a side entry garage, emotionally, that's what people want.
It looks bigger.
Some women go, you know what? It looks bigger. It looks a lot bigger. But some people, I don't want to drive by and see the front, door open and see all my stuff in the garage. But here's a good wedge. This is a good example of it. Plug it in the features. Square footage of this, who knows if it would be able to sell or not. The home was updated. This was a very difficult seller. Did not budge 1 inch from the 420. Actually thought his home was worth 485 when the home was first taken on. And by the way, I worked with Lori in the beginning, and she got him down to 420 by labeling out the threshold stuff and saying, hey, the buyer for your home is the one looking up for $400,000. But she was brand new into the business, and as that language went on, she said, I'm going to sell this home. I'm going to do it. Great, go do it. And it expired. So the key thing is learning this language, practicing it, applying some logic behind it, and going out there and talking it on a regular basis, and challenging yourself to not look at a CMA approach at all. Yes.
Okay. Here's a scenario. You're going out on competitive listing. Okay. You know that the other company is going to go out there and have all the CMA data. You walk in and you're going to take this approach. Are you going to be looked at as not having the data or being smarter for doing it in a different way?
I guess that depends on your presentation. This is what I did. Yeah. I never did a CMA.
I'm just kind of
I can
curious.
Tell you in the listing years that I did, I never did a CMA.
You can do both. You have
the CMA. You can do both.
You can have it.
But I'm going to tell you this. I made a fortune listing and selling. I never did a CMA. And I never had an argument with the seller. All right? And in the conversations, they might not have listened to me. Then I had a choice of do I keep on with this listing or not. But this is very logical-based stuff. And it goes a lot deeper. So when you really start looking at the market, it's a high school district. I'm going to go study the high school district. And I'm going to come back to you as the seller. I'm going to communicate how does your neighborhood stack up with the others. And I'm going to dive into your neighborhood and see where's the meat and potatoes and what are the odds of your home selling. What's the absorption rate in this high school district? By the way, the CMA people, do they do that?
No.
Yeah. As a consumer, which side sounds better to you just based off of, I'm going to study the high school district. I'm going to zero in. I'm going to look at the competition that we're looking at. I'm going to study the buying trends of what the buyers have been buying. And I'm going to analyze that based off your home and the five fundamental features that people tend to buy from.
Yours sounds better.
And nothing else matters. And by the way, here's how it can also work. Home and Chattahoochee River Club. It was a Shenandoah plan. Had a three-car garage, three-sides brick, finished basement in the cul-de-sac, five bedrooms and four baths on the main level, and a bedroom and bath in the basement. You could not find a home that matched higher on the criteria scale in the 400s than that home did. The agents that did CMAs, they went in and said, I think it was like 430 to 440. Okay? I went in and said, you've got everything that a buyer is going to want. You can go up as high as $500,000 because you've got every single thing that the consumer is going to want. The question is going to be, will they pay that in Chattahoochee River Club? And they did. And they went with us, but because it had five bedrooms, four baths on the main levels, three-car garage, three-sides brick, cul-de-sac lot, finished basement, what more could you want as a buyer looking up at $500,000? But by the CMA, when they went and compared other homes that didn't have all those features, it didn't match up to anywhere close to it.
Did it appraise?
Well, that was before the appraisal situation. It appraised just fine. They said, what do you think? I said, I think it should appraise.
Terry, I want to add something. I also read that you were teaching this to us when I joined the company many years ago. And I love thinking like this. As a matter of fact, I used to use a line, and I still do, my listing packages. The seller needs to think like a buyer. And that's usually what I start when I'm talking to them. You have to think like a buyer, and this is a perfect way to work into this type of thing. I know I even write it on the top thing, you got to think like a buyer. Because what I say to them is, if you hire me to work for you, what do you want me to do? Bring me the buyer. Well, then we got to think like the buyer so we know how we're going to get the buyer in here.
I mean, imagine just walking in and saying, the first thing I do in pricing the home is study the buying trends of the buyers, because that's all that matters.
Yeah. Yeah. But so, they don't think that way. The seller doesn't think that way. So when you say that to them, it's like...
And by the way, it feels a heck of a lot better when you get this down and you can say, hey, you know what? When the home doesn't sell, if you don't have a good solid strategy like this, that you can say, hey, I understand what you're looking for, and I believe your home is worth every penny, but unfortunately, all I can do is study the trends of buyers in this buying pattern, and this one feature of your home appears to be the big negative thing. Is there anything negative that can come between us? No. And guess what? The only thing that matters is we got to get the price closer to the buyer block that we talked about in the beginning. Remember, we talked about that person that's looking up to this price point? Well, obviously, the price that we're at right now is not effective to get them in here. So the question is, how close can we get to the buyer block that we're looking for? And all of a sudden, it takes all the onus off of me. It's not what can you do, what can you do? It's your fault. And all of a sudden, it's, hey, it's the market. It's true, though. I mean, think about it. You had a home out in Hampton, three bedrooms upstairs. Was it, you thought it'd be easier to sell than what it was? It did sell, but did it take longer than what you thought it would? Yes, I know it did because you told me.
It's back on the market, but the other one sold the three bedrooms as well.
So it hadn't sold yet? Okay. What was the price?
$349.
Size-wise, comp-wise, lot-wise, it's a great value, right? Yes. Three bedrooms upstairs with a master up. Mm. You've had that a long time. Five fundamental features.
I sold it once.
Bedroom bathroom ratio.
Today,
now, when the people get in there, nice lot, brand new home, everything works. But the problem is when they go out there and they go, God, do we really need that fourth bedroom upstairs? Even if they don't, if it's a master ups, what are they going to attract? More times than not, it's going to be a young family moving in there, a young couple that's going to think that their home is growing and expanding, so they need more bedrooms than what they have today, right? And that's a huge consideration. That's why master ups, the higher price you go, it's more critical, to have that fourth bedroom upstairs and extra bath. Back in 1992, it didn't matter if you had three baths upstairs, two baths was fine, but all of a sudden in the late 90s, custom builders started adding that third bath, and then everybody... One, if they had to have that extra bathroom upstairs. We're going to take a five-minute break, and then we're going to come in and we're going to do a little exercise and look at all the land club in the market. I'm going to show you how to dissect things down. 5 minutes. Take a break.
Don't yell at anybody, Wanda. The backyard, this is great.
She's got the bathroom on the main, another bathroom on the main, and two bedrooms on the main. It's like a 1.5 story. For an entry garage. Well taken care of. It's hard to open. Oh, not great. It's got a full unfinished basement.
One key on that.
I mean, I would say that's high.
What I'm saying is, since it's 270, okay, your buyer block is either going to be 225 to 250 or 250 to 270.
I think it's 250.
I mean, she's still okay, so. Let me use this as an example. I'm going to show people exactly what I go through in the process. So automatically, since they're going 2799, I go, they believe the home is worth more than what it really is. I've got two buyer blocks to look at. One they feel it's within and one below. So in this case, I go, I'm going to study between 225 and 250. I'm going to go look in those price blocks and see what are the neighborhoods that are selling, and how does it compare with that, and what are the features that are selling for that home. I'm going to tell you that stucco thing is going to be a big consideration.
Well, you know what's interesting? So, Maple Ridge, there's a big top behind it, but it's got a background wiring that's similar age neighborhood. The house sold with 3 bedrooms on the second floor, nothing on the main. I mean, in 1 day, I'm talking about it's under contract. 2 bedrooms, but then they've added. And a drive under basement, and they were priced at $289, which seemed unbelievably high. Now, it was a beautiful and nicely done house. But I was like, well, I would not have ever thought of it. And this happened like in the last 2 days.
Well,
but they're ready
for
this one. And they've already started building
it. You know, a non-stick. I'll give you some stuff to think about in between. I'll tell you what. How do you do that for
I'm going to go to the next one.
But it's scary. What were you saying? You said kiss of death. The kiss of death. And then you said just that back. And then you said the kiss of death.
Now, if you have three bedrooms with the master up.
So a total of four.
No, total of three.
So when you said if you have three bedrooms up with the master up.
I mean, three total. And if the master's up, that's where the kiss of death comes in. Because you only got two secondary bedrooms, and everybody thinks they need three secondary bedrooms.
Yes, well, that certainly is the kiss of death over.
Yeah, but people that have those homes don't. I mean, it's just you being able to go in there and dissect that down and be able to communicate that.
Well, who's that buyer in that case? It's not going to be a non-family because they need that extra bedroom. Well, if it's an older couple, like they would be on the same.
From time to time, we come across some shirts we can't sell. I say we that my wife has econ of sweet to make $250 in shirt.
That'd be nice. But we might have a couple seconds. All right, we're going to go ahead and get going in 30 seconds. Once you got through. All right. Y'all ready?
Yep.
We're in the home stretch. And trust me on this. It does, if it ends here for you and you don't practice this, you'll never get good at it. And the first time you try it, it's not going to come out as good as you want it. Here's your litany test for it. If you go present it and you see the head bob, what I call the head bob, you'll get it when you start explaining it correctly. And they'll follow right along with you. There's no argument. They start nodding their head. And when you see the head nod, then you're going, hey, this is actually working. If you don't do it right, you'll hear, yeah, but. And that means you're talking about their home not being worth it, and they're defending it. I hear you, but my home is worth more because of this. And that means you're not explaining it correctly. Because there's nothing that you can defend in what I'm saying. All I'm doing is looking at the market trends and relating it to your home and what the buying trends of the buyers were, and that's all I can do. So I'm going to act like we had a call come in Old Atlanta Club, and I'm going to say, hey, here's how you can start pulling this together. And if there's some of you that say, hey, I'd like to kind of explore this more, which I've already had that from some people, I can give you some exercise and we can work on it together, because the better and more proficient you get at it, you'll have a much higher percentage of things go your way, and you'll have a lot better control, a lot better ease in working through listings. So we get a call from Old Atlanta Club. we'll use Heather's example with the slab sale, $419.9. They said it was somewhere in the mid to high threes. We want to look at all the land club and go, what's really, let's get a quick snapshot of that community. And I'll walk you through what I would do and going, before I go to those people's home, I'm going to do this little quick statistical run. Some of this stuff you could print up, but the way that I always train myself, and have all some of the technological buttons and stuff. So I'm just going to act as though I used to do, which is I would have my pen, and I'd have a blank sheet of paper, and I'd start doing a little pick sheet thing. All right? So I'm going to walk you through it. You'll see it up here on the screen so you can know, okay, this is what Terry would do and how he dissects out the market. So Old Atlantic Club, we go in, and first I want to see what is active and if there's any contingency. So I just leave the top field. You can see here active, conditional, you know, contingent, whatever. And I'm just going to go look at those. You got seven deals. So on the side over here, I'm writing down OAC. Right now there's six actives and one that is contingency due diligence. I'm just going to come over here to the results section. All you need to do is look at the results. You don't really need to look. You're just getting an overall shot. So we got six homes that are active. The price is from 348 up to 512. A bulk of them in the 400s. So I come over here and go one that's in the 300s, four that's in the 400s, and one that's at 512. The one that's contingent, it's at 423.5. And then I'm going to go in and say, okay, go back to criteria. Now let's just go look and see of the things that have closed. We're going to go back 90 days.
Six months. I'm sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt you. Do you not consider pendings at all?
You can, but for this short little exercise, I'm just going to go ahead and bypass that. So today's date is March, what is it? I got March 2nd. March 5th. So here's how you got to apply a little logic. Agents, when you get a contract done, do you immediately get it into the office?
Yes,
no.
Sir.
No.
Yes.
It's real world, Linda. You don't. So I always put a little lag time in there. 3 to 4 days will give you enough lag time for people not bringing contracts in or closing and stuff like that. So I would say today's date, I'd say, okay, I'm just going to go back to 6 months from February 20th. So I'm going to go back February, January, December.
July.
Who can tell me what the hell 6 months is back to February 28th?
September.
In September.
September.
September. 9:30,
right? 9:28.
I get the book that says 6 months back. Yeah. That's like cheating.
So in Old Atlantic Club, since September 30th, there have been 15 closings. That's a decent amount. And all I want to do is go in here and go, what are the how's this neighborhood performing? I had this call. These people think their home is worth somewhere between 4 to 425. I'm just trying to kind of get the basis of what's going on in the neighborhood. So I'm going to come over here to the sales price and go down here. And we got 15 sales since September, end of September, 324 up to 491. And the most, I mean, they're pretty much scattered from the high threes through the fours. Is that important information, by the way?
Yes.
Yep. Mostly 400s, okay. Now, then what I'm going to do is I'm going to say, okay, you know what? It's important to know what's going on inside Old Atlanta Club, but we also need to look at Lambert High School. So we're going to go in here and plug in Lambert. And my people have said that they thought their home was worth somewhere around 4 to 425. So here's a big question. 4 to 425 is what the people said. What are the buyer blocks that we would be looking at since it's in the fours?
I would go 375 to 450.
Wrong. Next. That's what I don't know. No, actually, she's about dead on. Okay, so you want to keep them in the same spaces. So what I would do is I'd say I'm going to go 375 to 400 and 400 to 425. And those are going to be the two blocks that I study. Why would I study two blocks? By the way, here's how this all packaging coming together here. Why would I study two blocks? They told me 4 to 425. I'm looking 4 to 425, and I'm looking 375 to 400. Why?
Most people think their home is worth more than it really is.
All right. Now think about it. Most sellers will always think their home is worth more than what it really is. So if I ask somebody, tell me a $25,000 to $50,000 range of price, and you say 4 to 425, then almost with certainty, I need to study that one because your home is not usually going to stack up well with that one, and I'm going to study one below it because your home is probably going to stack up better in that one, and the numbers will all take care of themselves. Okay, so I go in and I'm going to plug in 375 to 400 in Lambert School District. My 6 months back is already plugged in. I've got two different. You're studying two different markets.
Oh. First thing
so first. I want to see the numbers
in
the one block versus the other block.
I got you.
Okay. So we go in there and we see that there are 14 sales from 375 to 400. Now, over here, you've got bedroom, bathroom, full bath, half bath. What else would you want to study out of this group? What would you need to study? What would you do from this? So we know right now, okay, there's 14 sales that have happened there.
Basement, two or three car garage.
If you're so what you would do is you go to the five fundamental features. What are the five fundamental features?
Foundation. A master bedroom.
You can have a cheat sheet, I don't care. You got the five fundamental features. And I'm going to look at the five fundamental features on each individual sale here.
Exterior finish, bedroom.
And I'm going to take out my tick sheet and I'm just going to mark down. How many of these 14 sales had a basement or a slab? How many of these sales had a master on the main? Because the home is a master on the main. What about the bedroom bathroom ratios? And I want to see how does that home stack up off the five fundamental features with these sales that have happened that the buyers bought these. By the way, if a home is active, what does it matter to you? Well, it doesn't matter much because it's not, the market's rejected that home at this point in time. Okay. By the way, that is the language that you can use. You can say, hey, I know the home down the street is active, but right now, to me, that just means the market has rejected it. Does that make sense? And you say that to somebody, it's like, that does make sense. It doesn't matter what somebody asks for it. If the market rejects it, it means nothing. Okay? So you just go into this and you go, here's my buyer pool. I need to go study this little sample of what the buyers bought, and then I'm going to go plug it in and see how many of these homes had the slab versus the basement, because at the end of the day, that's really the main driver that we're going to be analyzing is slab versus basement. And if it was a three-bedroom upstairs, would we be studying that if the master was up? Yes, we would. Mm-hmm. Right. The more that you do this, the more you'll not have to look at all five. You'll just go, I know that the ill of this home is this one feature, this two features, and you have studied the numbers to see how the patterns break down. So what else would you want to know the health of a market? It would be how many homes are active in that market, right? So we got 14 sales that have happened in the last 6 months. Let's find the actives for Lambert High School. Six. Six actives, 14 sales in the last 6 months. What's my
absorption
rate?
You're in the negative numbers.
Six.
Or 90. Or it's half. What is it?
About 2 months worth of inventory.
What is this again? This is the entire Lambert district with just three.
Nope. This is Lambert High School, 375 to 400.
Active.
Six homes are active. So it shows up there. Six homes are active. 14 sales in the last 6 months. What's my absorption rate? In other words, to wipe all these six homes that are active out of the equation based off the last 6 months of sales pattern. How many months would we have to go before those six are absorbed?
Three,
two.
2.3 months.
A little over two. 2.3
months.
You know it's less than three because three would be seven. Right. If there were seven active, then you have a 3 month supply. That makes sense?
Yes.
You all need to play with those numbers and stuff. But get that down so that as you're going through this exercise, you're going,
How's that little market, that little wedge? This $25,000 block in this case, $375 to $400, Lambert High School. We know is a very, is that a strong market, by the way?
Yes.
Oh, that's strong. I want to be in that market as a seller. It doesn't matter if I can get my price out of it. That's a market I want to be in. 2.3 months worth of inventory. Yes.
How do you account for like new inventory that's not even in the construction?
You just need to, you can't account for it. You need to be a student of the game out there and say, hey, you know what? This does not factor in pre-sales that have happened. But this market is very hot, and if you've got a new home in construction that is in that price point, it's going to be selling off the hook.
Yeah, but you're only comparing resales, not new construction.
But that's the health of a market. You need to know what's going on with the new home construction.
70% of the new home is resold.
Okay, so this is very simple. So we've got 2.3 months worth of inventory. We got 6 homes active, and we got 14 sales. Let's just assume that, I'm going to plug a number in here, that 5 out of the 14 homes that sold were slabs. Okay? Is that fine? So in your little equation, 375 to 400, 5 of 14 sold with slabs. Now what are we going to do? We need to study the 4 to 425. Now look at this. Automatically, you go to 10 homes available. It's not a huge change, but it is a change, right? So 4 to 425, there are 10 homes that are active in Lambert High School. You write that down. Of the closings, these are ones we want to dive into, and we want to see how many. Well, look at this, 8, 4 to 425. What's your absorption rate for 4 to 425?
About 6 months.
8 sales in 6 months, 10 homes active.
1.5.
Oh, it's about 6 months.
Yeah. 6 months of sales were 8, right?
Which is
6 months of sales had 8 sales. There are 10 homes available. You know it's going to take longer than 6 months. Because in 6 months, you only have 8. So how much longer than 6 will it take to absorb 10? Let's just say 1 extra month. So you got 7 months worth of inventory. Tell me what the absorption rate was for 375 to 400.
2.3.
And what's the absorption rate for 4 to 425? 7. As a consumer, which market would you rather be in?
The 375 to 400, 2.3 months.
Just off the trends and stuff, right? No? You're analyzing the different trends in the markets. Now, let's say out of this group, 2 homes sold that had slabs. 2 of the 8. Now, do you feel like if you did this on listing appointments and you went in and said, I know what the ill is of this home of the 5 fundamental features, and I studied the trends between these 2 buyer blocks, do you feel like you'd have a little bit more control and a little bit of dialogue? And right now you might be a little cloudy. You're going, okay, I'm not really sure exactly how we got here, but interesting. Is it interesting, by the way?
Oh, yeah.
So, one, how does, and Amanda's got to go pick up the child. Everybody say bye, Amanda.
Bye, Amanda.
Thank you for coming. By the way, in 2 weeks, a week and a half, she's going to teach a little marketing thing for you with some of the Century 21 stuff. It'll be 20 minutes of the sales meeting, so the week I come back, which will be a week and a half, Amanda will come up here and spend about 20 minutes going over some things, and I'll say Amanda has a marketing company. And the things that she applies in her business, she gets her business from the marketing efforts she puts out there. So things that you can learn from her and apply in your business, it's awesome. So I highly encourage you guys come for that Tuesday sales meeting. So, dang it. So tell me where you could go with this. I'm not going to bother calling Austin back there. I really kind of want to leave this open for question and answer, because here's the deal. This is a perfect example. When Heather called me about that home, I said, I know the neighborhood though, so I said, look, Heather, if it's done that nice, and they added a bed, they added a bathroom upstairs, which greatly increased sellability because of the bedroom bathroom ratio. And I said, here's the deal. It's $399.9
sell within 30 days. 419.9, you got a chance. You can't go above 419.9. And I was absolutely with it. I said, you cannot go a dime above 419.9. But you could go there if it's really that nice. And I believe that if you go there and it's that nice, then within 10 showings, you'll probably get an offer. Now, you did get an offer, right? We'll see what happens with it. But went on the market the other day. It's already got an offer. It's all based off the psychological process and how it looked online, because the home showed very well online. But the buyer for that home was looking up to $400,000. We went into it with absolutes, going, you know what, if you didn't have the basement, you can go a lot higher. But without the basement, the buyer for your home is the one that's looking up to $400,000. Period. And by the way, this is the language that I speak is always with absolutes. Because if you walk into somebody's home and say, let me tell you how buyers buy. The buying patterns of buyers are buying $25,000 to $50,000 blocks until they get to the 500s. When you go in there and start 10, you know what the people do? Okay, all right, that makes sense, because they all bought and they bought in a wedge. And they typically paid more than what they really thought that they wanted to. And so you're just talking to them, and that's why they start nodding their head. But you got to be absolute with it. You got to buy into this stuff. You got to go, hey, own the numbers where they are. Up to $300,000, what are your buying blocks? $25,000. And big, fat, solid lines. $300,000 to $400,000, what are they? Three to a soft 325, or three 350, 350 to three soft 375, or 350 to four. And you go into it with these absolutes. If I have a price of $350,000, well, this would be a good one. Tell me my psychological number. If my price, if my buyer block is really 350, what's my psychological number to get somebody in my door?
399.
369.9. My buyer block is up to 350. What's my psychological number to get somebody to come in my room? 369.9. And then what's my pricing strategy? 4999. Nothing else matters. And then if somebody says, well, my home's 112, I want to price my home 112.5. I don't do that. Why don't you do that? It's either going to be 114.9 or 109.9. Which would you rather go? And by the way, if it's 109.9 or 114.9, who's the buyer for my home? If I'm expecting my price to be 109.9 to 114.9, who's the buyer for my home? Up to $100,000.
I need to change
the price. I just priced one at $194.5. $194.5. $400 more. Hey, I'm
going to
get you $400 more. I got it. But if you get in this, and by the way, when other agents go and go, well, I'm going to price it at $500. I'm going to try to get the 5 to 550 person and the 450 to 500. If somebody's looking at 550, they're going to buy a $500,000 home. Okay? And if I'm going in to list a home, I'm going to say, you know what, here's the deal. I price it according to the way that people spend millions of dollars doing in the marketing to find out how you price. We're going to price you out at $499.9 to be the shining star out of that mix. Because the person that's looking up to $550 is going to buy $550 or more. Period. I believe that. It's based off of a lot of logic, facts, and experiences. And I go into it going, these are the absolutes. And you know what happens with the consumer? They typically will follow right along. Now, they might buck it at first, but as long as you introduce it to them on the first thing, you can go up there and go, the buyer for your home is either the one looking, by the way, the one that's 4 to 425 or 375 to 400. How I present that to you as a consumer when I first meet you is I'd say, look, you said your home was probably worth 4 to 425. I've studied the market from 4 to 425 and 375 to 400. I'll go over the trends with you so that you can see it. But I told you the price you wanted to hear first, and then told you about the second one below that. If I told you I studied the price of 375 to 400 and 4 to 425, you'll hear 375 to 400, and you'll think I'm trying to get you down from not. Okay? Does that make sense? I mean, you really got to think of it. There's a lot of psychology that goes into you communicate with people and what they interpret from the time that something comes out of your mouth, and do they listen to anything else or not? So, any questions? I will be covering more of this I wanted to get this introduced out there because I have not taught this in a long, long time.
But it's great. It's good. Yes.
But this is what I used. This is what I did. I never have done a CMA, and this works. You've got to challenge yourself. You got to go, hey, let me go test my home. Let me go look at the five fundamental features. You get to know those five fundamental features intimately and go, hey, if I come up and you go, what are the five fundamental features? You should be able to nail them off without thinking about it, without looking at a piece of paper, and start focusing on those things. And then when you go into a listing appointment, going, hey, let me study the two different buyer blocks. Let me go in there and see if I can find the ill. And let me see if I can communicate with the people this strategy and see if they start to go along with me. And I promise you, if you do, you're going to have quicker closings, you're going to have more satisfied people, and you are going to be more satisfied because you won't have the tension between them and the sellers. Any questions? Well, if not, we're going to be done. Any questions?
Is that an absolute?
That is absolute. So we will continue this stuff on. Remember, it is recorded. And this was Ralph. I apologize because it's been a long time since I've taught it. We'll get better. Does that make sense?
It makes sense.
Perfect. Y'all have a great day. Thank you very much.
So I guess everybody knows that.
I'm going to make a phone call.